Well, thanks very much indeed. Our first witness is Dr. Taras Kuzio, who's professor of political science at Kyiv University and author of Russian Nationalism and the Russian-Ukrainian War, which with exquisite timing is out this week. Dr. Kuzio, what's at the bottom of this conflict in your view?
Well, the bottom of it is that this is the first land grab, Crimean annexation, since World War II. Secondly, there is a question of Britain and United States' moral right to help Ukraine. They both signed up to the so-called Budapest Memorandum in 1994, which in return for Ukraine giving up the world's third largest nuclear weapons arsenal, they were given security assurances by Britain and the US. Thirdly, this is an artificial crisis. There was no intention of NATO to give Ukraine membership, and there was never any intention for the US to install missiles in Ukraine. And fourthly, and the key core question, is that this is a racist and colonial approach to Ukraine. Russia, on a daily basis, denies the very existence of Ukraine and Ukrainians.
Okay, let me stop you there, because you said an awful lot that we need to examine. Tim Stanley.
Right.
To what extent is the West partly to blame? Because by offering to protect Ukraine, by always offering up the possibility of NATO membership, never quite ruling it out, it actually has put Ukraine on the front line, because Russia feels it has to do something to prove that that will not happen.
NATO isn't really the core issue. The core issue is that Russia denies the right of Ukraine to exist as a country. I, without exaggeration, say that Vladimir Putin is obsessed with Ukraine. He believes Ukraine is a Russian land, like Belarus, and that Ukraine, Belarus, and Russia are part of what he calls the Russian world. And therefore, he denies the very right of Ukraine to decide anything of its own.
Right. So let's say that potential NATO membership is a pretext, and it's a cynical one. But what I'm suggesting is that the West might have some responsibility for helping to create that pretext by reaching out to Ukraine in the way it's done in the last decade or so.
I don't think the West as such has done this. This is a purely more domestic development in both Ukraine and in Russia. I'm not a big fan of the Soviet Union, but the Soviet Union recognized Ukraine as a separate country and a separate people. Today's Kremlin does not. Okay. That's the big difference.
Why should Britain take responsibility for defending the independence of Ukraine?
Firstly, it's the leading country in Europe in NATO. Secondly, together with the US and Russia, of course, Russia reneged on that, but together with the US, Britain gave Ukraine security guarantees, security assurances, it depends how you define them, in 1994, in return for Ukraine giving up nuclear weapons. Why should North Korea and Iran give up or not have nuclear weapons if they see how Ukraine has been treated
right
when it gave up nuclear weapons?
But if one can shift the moral locus from Russia to Britain, my point is, why is our tiny country many, many miles away, why has it got to be the moral leader on defending the sovereignty of a country which isn't, as we've just discussed, isn't even in NATO?
It's not in NATO, but Ukraine borders four NATO members. And therefore, any conflict, any hot war inside Ukraine will not remain within Ukraine. The Baltic states will literally go crazy about this. They will demand all sorts of NATO military presence because they will believe that they are next. The fear in that part of the world is, of course, a domino effect. Once Ukraine is gone, then who's next?
Understood. Ashsaka?
It's interesting to hear you talk of the domino effect, which is, of course, a Cold War term. So to maybe bring us back into that world of moral opposites, could you just talk a little bit about what you view the moral purpose of a NATO intervention in the Ukraine as being?
But there wouldn't be a NATO intervention. I think it's a wrong analogy to compare this to Iraq and Afghanistan. Nobody's talking about NATO or British troops going to Ukraine. What we're talking about is military assistance, not British troops or NATO troops on the ground.
But in terms of military assistance, let's talk about then, say, arming or supporting elements within Ukraine. Now, some of those include neo-fascist elements like the Azov battalion. So how does a support for democracy, for freedom, for the self-determination of a people square with the messy work of arming and allying groups who do not have those values as their aim?
Well, I think you need to be very clear as to what you're talking about here, because there is no such thing as a neo-fascist battalion in Ukrainian military or the National Guard. So I'm not quite clear what you're talking about here. There are far-right groups, of course, one in particular called National Corps, which has neo-Nazi tendencies. Those exist in every country, including Britain. But there isn't a neo-fascist battalion or group in the Ukrainian security forces. I deny that.
But if we talk about, looking at the history of what happens when the West has armed and allied with groups, particularly in contested border regions, that has often meant the empowerment of groups who do not have democratic, liberal values. Do you not think that that is a risk here? And if so, what responsibility does the West have to manage that risk?
Britain, in Ukraine's elections, have the lowest electoral support anywhere in Europe for the far right. I can back that up with all sorts of arguments. The far right in Ukraine never gets electoral support in Ukraine, compared to anywhere in Europe. The rate of anti-Semitism in Ukraine is extremely low. The highest, actually, by the way, is in France and Germany, not in Eastern Europe. The idea that somehow this is empowered, what it has empowered in Ukraine is a sense of patriotism. When you look at Ukrainian opinion polls, it shows that Ukrainians have an intense dislike for Russian leaders, like Vladimir Putin, but not for the Russian people. That is patriotism, not ethnic nationalism. And I've just published, actually this week, a second book, an edited collection about an Eastern Ukrainian region called Dnipropetrovsk, which is adjacent to the war zone, and talking about how Russian-speaking Ukrainians and Jews, it's a big Jewish revival in that region, have actually supported Ukraine.
I must stop you there, Dr. Kuzio, but thank you very much indeed for joining us this evening.